Hello students, let us continue last unit of professional ethics and Indian constitution subject, that is Indian constitution. I already covered 16 questions in my first session of this Indian constitution unit. Okay, so today let us continue the remaining questions of model question bank prescribed by BTE Karnataka State. So the remaining questions belong to application type category. Okay, under that we will discuss some of the questions. Okay, so the first question in this session, that is 17th question from this unit totally, explain the formation and composition of constituent assembly. 5 marks question it is. So even before the Indian Independence Act 1947, the constituent assembly had been set up in order to establish the constitution of India. So the main intention of establishing this constituent assembly after independence to India in the year 1947, in order to establish constitution for ruling India, for any government to rule any nation, constitution is required. So what is constitution? We already discussed in our part 1 discussion. This was done due to an agreement between the cabinet mission and the major Indian political parties in 1946, and it was decided to elect the constituent assembly, which should be elected by the members of recently elected to the legislative assemblies of the provinces. The constituent assembly has come into existence in November 1946. After the passing of Indian Independence Act 1947, the Constituent Assembly became an independent body. So before Independence Act, it was under control of the British rule. Okay, so after independence in the year 1947, this Constituent Assembly became an independent body. The strength of the constituent making body was to be 389, which consisting of 296 representatives from British India and 93 representatives from the Indian native states. Okay, next, explain preamble and its main objectives of Indian constitution. So after formation of Indian constitution, every citizen of India should know the brief introduction about our constitution. So the main objective of this preamble to Indian constitution is to give a brief introduction about our detailed Indian constitution. So what exactly that Indian constitution consists of? So it is actually prepares to the constitution, and it aims to explain the objectives of the constitution and also expressing underlying philosophy and the fundamental values on which the constitution is based to every citizen of India. Okay, the objectives, the main objectives of preamble of the constitution are as follows. The first one is to represent we, means the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitution of India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. So what type of India is, what type of ruling, and what type of electing our representatives to form the government. Okay, so that will be the main objective of this preamble of Indian constitution. Next, second one is to represent the social, economic and political justice to all citizens of India. So being a democratic nation, in India, everyone, means every citizen of India, should enjoy the social, economic and political opportunities. Okay, to represent liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship. So every Indian is having full liberty of thinking on any particular matter he or she wishes. And every Indian is having free to express or for any kind of expression. And whatever beliefs we have in our day-to-day life, so nobody can question on it. We can put faith on anybody. And according to our religion, we can do worships. Okay. Next, to represent the equality of status and opportunity to all citizens. So in India, no, as a democratic nation, every citizen will be treated equally. To represent fraternity. Assuring dignity of the individuals and unity and integrity of the nation. So fraternity means every Indian should treat others as their brothers and sisters. To present the aspirations and wishes of the people of India. To declare the aims and objectives of the Constitution of India. To express philosophy and fundamental values on which the Constitution is based. So democratic philosophy we have for our Constitution. Okay. So next question. Explain the fundamental rights of every citizen. 5 marks question. Fundamental rights andra moolabhoota hakkugalu. Okay. So the fundamental rights are the basic rights given to the citizens by the Constitution of the country and which are essential for man to lead a decent and respectable life and to attain fullest development of his human personality. So these are classified into 6 heads. As the first one is the right to equality. It is described in article number 14 to 18. The right of freedom, article number 19 to 22, consists of explanation of right of freedom. The right against exploitation. If we get exploited by anybody, how to overcome from that exploitation? Means exploitation means putting pressure, money, using money power, political power, or government facilities. If anybody is exploiting or putting pressure on us, we have right against such exploitation, which is explained in article number 23 and 24. The right of freedom of religion. We can join any religion and we can follow the principles of that religion. There are no any restrictions on that. The cultural and educational rights. We can participate in cultural activities and we can take any kind of education, that is our right. The rights to constitutional remedies. So suppose our rights are being exploited by anybody or any organization, no? So our constitution provides remedies to recover our rights. Okay. So next question, explain the fundamental duties of every citizen. 10 marks question. So meaning of fundamental duties. The fundamental duties of our constitution are the code of conduct for the citizen of the country which they are expected to follow in their actions and reactions. Okay. So the fundamental duties are reflected in the form of actions and reactions. Okay. So how do we behave and what duties we need to follow for our livelihood? For that a particular code of conduct is needed, so that we get from this fundamental duties. Okay. Section of Indian Constitution. The objectives of fundamental duties are to make citizen to be aware of their social and economic obligations, to warn them to do and not to do certain things in the interest of their country. So fundamental duties means don't think that we can do anything. So whatever we do, that should be in the interest of our nation. It should not harm the integrity of our nation. So list of fundamental duties. Our constitution has introduced 10 fundamental duties in article number 5, which are as follows. Every citizen of India to stand for the constitution and to respect its ideals and institutions, the national flag and national anthem. The citizen of India must appreciate and follow the noble ideals which inspired our national struggle for freedom. Every Indian must uphold and protect the sovereignty, unity and integrity of India. Every Indian is expected to defend the country and render national service whenever necessary. Every Indian should promote harmony and the spirit of common brotherhood among all, to value and preserve the rich heritage of our composite culture, to protect and improve natural environment like forests, lakes, rivers and wildlife, to develop the specific temper humanism and the spirit of inquiry and reform, to safeguard public property and to avoid violence. Last one, to struggle towards excellence of the nation's higher levels of effort and achievement. Next question, explain salient features of Indian constitution. 10 marks question it is. It's a very important question. So many occasions this question has been repeated. If you refer previous question papers. Features of Constitution of India. The Constitution of India is a comprehensive document and it has several outstanding salient features which are as follow. The first one is lengthiest constitution in the world. It is a written constitution and it is partly rigid and partly flexible, means you cannot easily modify the contents of our constitution, and some part we can change. Okay, a federation with strong centralizing tendency. So central government is having a supreme power in ruling the nation. Parliamentary form of government. A secular state means every religion, every caste will be treated equally. Single citizenship. So Indians are having single citizenship. Fundamental rights, as I already explained. Dietary principles of state policy. Establishment of welfare state. Fundamental duties. Adult suffrage or adult franchisee. And to participate in general election, to represent or to elect our representatives, no, we should have certain eligibility criteria with respect to age. Okay, that is called as adult suffrage. And independent judiciary. As I told, no, our constitution consists of three parts: legislative system, executive system, and judiciary system. All these three parts are independently working. So like that, we have independent judiciary, official language. Hindi and English are already considered as official language for India. Creation of all India services like competitive exams, IAS exam, IPS exam, IAS exams. Next, special status to Jammu and Kashmir according to article number 370. Right from Independence Act 1947 now. So this state, Jammu and Kashmir, was given a special status like a independent nation. Recently, the ruling government had removed that status to Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, that we know it. Next question, explain the basic structure of Parliament. So structure of Parliament we have to explain. It is a 10 marks question, detailed question it is. So in our Constitution of India, according to article number 79, the legislature of the Union Government, called the Union Parliament, that consists of three organs. These are President, Council of States, which is called as Rajya Sabha, House of People, the lower floor of our parliament. It is called as Lok Sabha. The President of India is an integral part of our parliament. Though he is not member of either houses of the parliament, he does the certain works relating to the proceedings of the parliament. The president summons the two houses of parliament, dissolves the house of people and gives assent to various bills proposed by both the floors of our parliament. Okay, this means that president is having supreme power to rule the nation. Lok Sabha is a popular house, and I already told that it is House of People, and also it is called as lower house of our parliamentary system. Composition of Lok Sabha, it consists of not more than 530 members directly elected from the different constituencies of states and not more than 20 members from union territories. Means ಭಾರತದ ರಾಜ್ಯಗಳಿಂದ ಅನೇಕ ಲೋಕಸಭಾ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರಗಳಿಂದ ಒಟ್ಟಾರೆ 530 ಸದಸ್ಯರನ್ನು ನಾವು ಪ್ರತಿ 5 ವರ್ಷಕ್ಕೊಮ್ಮೆ ಆರಿಸಿ ಕಳಿಸುತ್ತೇವೆ ಮತ್ತು ಕೇಂದ್ರಾಡಳಿತ ಪ್ರದೇಶಗಳಿಂದ 20 ಸದಸ್ಯರನ್ನು ನಾವು ಈ ಒಂದು ಲೋಕಸಭಾಕ್ಕೆ ಆಯ್ಕೆ ಮಾಡುವ ವಿಧಾನವನ್ನು ಹೊಂದಿದ್ದೇವೆ ಓಕೆ ಇನ್ ಎಡಿಷನ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಸಿಡೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಮೇ ನಾಮಿನೇಟ್ 2 ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ to represent the Anglo-Indian community. Hence, the maximum strength of our Lok Sabha becomes 552. The candidate may contest any parliamentary constituency in the election to the Lok Sabha, and these are elected directly by the people. Term. Generally, the Lok Sabha has a term of 5 years from the date fixed for its first meeting. Election result bandh milalla. ಇಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸ್ ಮುಗಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಯಾವ ಒಂದು ರಾಜಕೀಯ ಪಕ್ಷಕ್ಕೆ ಬಹುಮತ ಸಿಗುತ್ತದೆ ಆ ಒಂದು ಪಕ್ಷದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾಯಕನನ್ನು ಆರಿಸಿ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರಪತಿಯವರಿಗೆ ಮನವಿಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸಲಾಗುತ್ತದೆ ಸರ್ಕಾರವನ್ನು ರಚಿಸಲು ಅವರು ಅನುಮತಿ ನೀಡಿದ ಮೇಲೆ ಮೊಟ್ಟ ಮೊದಲನೇ ಬಾರಿ ಯಾವ ದಿನ ಸಭೆಯನ್ನು ಕರೆಯಲಾಗೋದು ಆ ದಿನದಿಂದ 5 ವರ್ಷದವರೆಗೆ ಆ ಒಂದು ಪಕ್ಷ ದೇಶದ ಆಡಳಿತದ ಚುಕ್ಕಾಣಿಯನ್ನು ಹಿಡಿಯಲಾಗುತ್ತದೆ ಓಕೆ ಅಂಡರ್ ದ ಎಮರ್ಜೆನ್ಸಿ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ಸ್ ದ ಲೋಕ್ ಸಭಾ ಟರ್ಮ್ ಮೇ ಬಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಡೆಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸೀಡಿಂಗ್ 1 ಇಯರ್ ಅಟ್ ದ ಟೈಮ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸೀಡಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಎನಿ ಕೇಸ್ ಪೀರಿಯಡ್ ಆಫ್ 6 ಮಂತ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಪ್ರೊಕ್ಲೇಮೇಷನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಸೀಸ್ ಟು ಆಪ್ರೇಟ್ Rajya Sabha, it is upper house of the parliament and is also known as the House of Elders. Composition, it consists of not more than 250 members. In this 250 members, 238 members are elected by the members of the various legislative assemblies of the states and the union territories, and 12 members are nominated by the president from persons of special knowledge or practical experience in respect of literature, science and social service. These members are indirectly elected by elected members of legislative assemblies of the states and union territories. Term for Rajya Sabha. Rajya Sabha is a permanent house and it is not subjected to dissolution like Lok Sabha. These members are elected for a period of 6 years. These members will retire after their term and the same members will be re-elected. Okay. Next question. Explain the composition of Lok Sabha. Already we covered answer to this question in previous question. That is question number 22. Explain the composition of Rajya Sabha. 5 marks question. It is also covered in previous question. That is question number 22. Explain the directive principles of state policy. 5 marks question. So, directive principles of state policy. These are contained in part 4 of the constitution. The directive principles of state policy set out the aims and objectives to be attained by the states in the governance of the country. The idea of welfare state, seen in our constitution can be achieved only if the states attempt to implement the directive principles with a high sense of moral duty. So it may be noted that unlike the fundamental rights, the rights provided under the directive principles of state policy are not justifiable. In case the state is unable to implement any provision of Part 4 of our Constitution, no action can be taken against the state in court of law. Because of this limitation, there has been much criticism against the directive principles. But the criticism is not justified. Though by its nature, the directive principles are not enforceable in a court of law, the government authorities cannot ignore them because they are answerable for their non-implementation to electorate at the time of election. So this is about directive principles of state policy. So before proceeding to next question, so let us discuss the meaning of the directive principles of state policy in Kannada. Okay, rajaneetiya nirdeshana tattvagalu anta idanna kannadadage ಕರೆಯಲಾಗೋದು. ಓಕೆ, ಇವು ಸಂವಿಧಾನದ ಭಾಗ 4ರಲ್ಲಿವೆ. ರಾಜನೀತಿಯ ನಿರ್ದೇಶನ ತತ್ವಗಳು ದೇಶದ ಆಡಳಿತದಲ್ಲಿ ರಾಜ್ಯಗಳು ಸಾಧಿಸಬೇಕಾದ ಗುರಿ ಮತ್ತು ಉದ್ದೇಶಗಳನ್ನು ತಿಳಿಸುತ್ತವೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ಸಂವಿಧಾನದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಂಡುಬರುವ ಒಂದು ಕಲ್ಯಾಣ ರಾಜ್ಯದ ಕಲ್ಪನೆಯನ್ನು ಸಾಧಿಸಬಹುದು. ರಾಜ್ಯಗಳು ನಿರ್ದೇಶನ ತತ್ವಗಳನ್ನು ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ನೈತಿಕ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯದಿಂದ ಕಾರ್ಯಗತಗೊಳಿಸಿದರೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ಉದ್ದೇಶ ಸಾಕಾರವಾಗೋದು ಸಾಧ್ಯವಾಗುತ್ತದೆ. ಮೂಲಭೂತ ಹಕ್ಕುಗಳಿಗಿಂತ ಇದು ಭಿನ್ನವಾಗಿವೆ. ರಾಜನೀತಿಯ ನಿರ್ದೇಶನ ತತ್ವಗಳ ಅಡಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಒದಗಿಸಲಾದ ಹಕ್ಕುಗಳು ಸಮರ್ಥನೀಯವಲ್ಲ ಎಂದು ಗಮನಿಸಬಹುದು. ನಮ್ಮ ಸಂವಿಧಾನದ ಭಾಗ 4ರ ಯಾವುದೇ ನಿಬಂಧನೆಯನ್ನು ಜಾರಿಗೆ ತರಲು ರಾಜ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯವಾಗದಿದ್ದರೆ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯದಲ್ಲಿ ರಾಜ್ಯದ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಯಾವುದೇ ಕ್ರಮ ಕೈಗೊಳ್ಳಲಾಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ. ಈ ಮಿತಿಯಿಂದ ನಿರ್ದೇಶನ ತತ್ವಗಳ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಟೀಕೆಗಳು ಮೂಡಿಬಂದಿವೆ. ಆದರೆ ಈ ಟೀಕೆ ಸಮರ್ಥನೀಯವಲ್ಲ. ಅದರ ಸ್ವಭಾವತ ನಿರ್ದೇಶನ ತತ್ವಗಳನ್ನು ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಜಾರಿಗೊಳಿಸಲಾಗದಿದ್ದರೂ ಸರ್ಕಾರಿ ಅಧಿಕಾರಿಗಳು ಅವುಗಳನ್ನು ನಿರ್ಲಕ್ಷಿಸಲು ಸಾಧ್ಯವಿಲ್ಲ. ಏಕೆಂದರೆ ಅವರು ಚುನಾವಣೆ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಮತದಾರರಿಗೆ ಅನುಷ್ಠಾನಗೊಳಿಸುವುದಕ್ಕೆ ಉತ್ತರಿಸುತ್ತಾರೆ. ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್, ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಜುಡಿಷರಿ. ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರ್ ಆಫ್ ಜುಡಿಷರಿ. ಅವರ್ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಪ್ರೊವೈಡೆಡ್ ಆ್ಯನ್ ಇಂಟಿಗ್ರೇಟೆಡ್ ಸಿಂಗಲ್ ಜುಡಿಷರಿ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್. ದ ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಈಸ್ ಆಟ್ ದ ಅಪೆಕ್ಸ್, ಆಟ್ ದ ಟಾಪ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್, ಈಸ್ ದ ಹೈಯೆಸ್ಟ್ ಜುಡಿಷರಿ ಆರ್ ಜುಡಿಷಿಯಲ್ ಅಥಾರಿಟಿ. ದ ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆಟ್ ದ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಆರ್ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಟು ದಿ ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್. ದ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆಟ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಆರ್ ಸೂಪರ್ವೈಸ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ದಿ ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸಿ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರ್ ಆಫ್ ಜುಡಿಷರಿ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಆಟ್ ಅಪೆಕ್ಸ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಟಾಪ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್. ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಟು ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಟು ದಿ ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ಅಗೇನ್ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕ್ರಿಮಿನಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ರೆವಿನ್ಯೂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ಓಕೆ, ರೈಟ್ ದ ಶಾರ್ಟ್ ನೋಟ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ಜುರಿಸ್ಡಿಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್, ದ ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್, ಕ್ರಿಮಿನಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್, ರೆವಿನ್ಯೂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್, ದ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಅ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಪ್ರಿಸೈಡೆಡ್ ಓವರ್ ಬೈ ದ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಜಡ್ಜ್ who is also sessions judge below district court. There are courts of subordinate judges or munsips. Appeals from subordinate civil courts lie first in district court and then sent to the high court. It exercises both original and appellate jurisdiction in civil cases. It supervises the subordinate courts in the district. Next, criminal courts. It is also called session court and presided over by the sessions judge. He or she can pass the death sentence, but it has to be confirmed by the high court before execution. Below this court, there are municipal courts. The revenue courts are headed by the district collector, assistant commissioner, and tahsildar. They hear revenue cases of the district. Okay. Next question. Explain the powers of Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha. 10 marks question. Powers of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, that is parliament. So both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha togetherly called as parliament. The parliament of India has extensive powers like legislative powers, administrative powers and financial powers. Legislative power. Article number 246 of Indian Constitution tells that Union Parliament will have exclusive powers of jurisdiction to make a law on matters which are given in the Union List and Concurrent List. Next, administrative power. A motion, no confidence, is a parliamentary motion whose passing would demonstrate to the head of the state that the elected parliament no longer has confidence in the appointed government. When a parliament passes a vote of no confidence in an existing government, the head of the state must respond in one of two ways. So ask another individual who he believes will command the confidence of parliament to try to form a government as per law of constitution. Next, dissolve the elected parliament and call a general election to elect the new parliament as per the law of parliament. Avishwasa gottuli madod antar adakke yade ondo sarkaradalli vishwasa illadaga mattobba nayakananna yade ondo pakshada nayaka avanga bahumata iddara avaru mundina sarkaravanna nadisabodu illadara ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಚಾಲ್ತಿ ಇರುವ ಸರ್ಕಾರನ್ನು ಡಿಸಾಲ್ವ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಮತ್ತೊಮ್ಮೆ ಎಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬೋದು. ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್, ಫೈನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಪವರ್. ಅಕಾರ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಟು ದ ಆರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ ನಂಬರ್ 112 ಆಫ್ ದ ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ, ಅ ಫೈನಾನ್ಸ್ ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಸಬ್ಮಿಟ್ಸ್ ದಿ ಬಜೆಟ್ ಆರ್ ಫೈನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಬಿಫೋರ್ ದ ಹೌಸಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಪಾರ್ಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ಪರ್ಮಿಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೆಸಿಡೆಂಟ್. ಓಕೆ. ಸೊ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್, ರೈಟ್ the short notes on division of powers, union list, state list and concurrent list. 10 marks question. So according to constitution of India, no, for a government to rule the nation, certain powers are required. Okay, so this power is divided into three lists, in the form of three lists. They are called as union list, state list and concurrent list. However, foreseeing the possibility of situation in which legislation might be required on matters that are not mentioned in any of the three lists. So the first one is union list. The union list consists of 100 items on which the parliament has exclusive power to legislate, and these are defense, armed forces, arms and ammunition, atomic energy, foreign affairs, war and peace, citizenship, extradition, railways, shipping and navigation, airways, posts and telegraphs, wireless and broadcasting, currency, foreign trade, interstate trade and commerce, banking, insurance, central of industries, regulation and development of mines, mineral and oil resources, electronics, audit of government accounts, constitution and ordination of the Supreme Court, High Courts, Union Public Service Commission, income tax, custom duties and export duties, duties of excise, corporation tax, taxes on capital value of assets, state duty, terminal taxes. State list. The state list consists of 61 items on which the state has exclusive power to legislative, and these are maintaining law and order within the state, police forces, health care, transport, land policies, electricity in the state, village administration, etc. The state has exclusive power to make laws on these subjects, but in certain circumstances now the parliament can also make laws on subject mentioned in the state list. Then the parliament has to pass resolution with 2/3 majority that it is expedient to legislate on the state list in the national interest. Third one, concurrent list. In this case, both the parliament and the states will going to have the powers as per the directions from the Constitution of India. The concurrent list consists of 52 items, and these are marriage and divorce, transfer of property other than agriculture land, education, contracts, bankruptcy and insolvency, trustees and trusts, civil procedure, contempt of court, adulteration of foodstuffs, drugs and poisons, economic and social planning, trade union, labor welfare, electricity, newspapers, books and printing press, stamp duties. Okay. Next, explain the federalism in the Indian Constitution. Federalism in the Indian Constitution. Article number 1 of the Indian Constitution declares that India shall be an union of state. Part L1 of the Indian Constitution defines the power distribution between federal government, the central or union government, and states in the nation. The power is divided between legislative, administrative and executive powers. The legislative section is divided into 3 lists, and these are union list, state list and concurrent list. Unlike the federal governments of America, Switzerland or Australia, residual powers remain with the center as the Canadian federal government. The constitutional powers given to each state are not the same. The states of Jammu and Kashmir was accorded higher degree of federalism under Article number 370 of the Indian Constitution. The states of Pondicherry and Delhi are accorded lesser degree of federalism under Article 239A and 239AA respectively. The Union Territories are directly governed by the central government or union government. Explain the federalism in the Indian Constitution. This is the answer. Okay. So federalism andre enu? So federalism means the government, nation's government powers distributed into 3 sections. So first section is related to governance of central government, and second list with respect to state governance, and third list consists of mix of participation from central as well as state governments. Okay. So America, Switzerland, Australia, Yauriti ಕಾನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಪ್ರಕಾರ ತಮ್ಮ ದೇಶವನ್ನು ಆಳ್ತಾವಲ್ಲ, ಆ ಒಂದು ಆಧಾರದ ಮೇಲೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ಫೆಡರಲಿಸಮ್ ಇನ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಮಾಡಲಾಗಿದೆ. ಓಕೆ. ಸೊ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್, ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ ದ ರೋಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಕೌನ್ಸಿಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟರ್ಸ್. Council of Ministers in the state According to the Constitution of India, there should be Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister under Article Number 163, Part 1, to aid and advise the Governor during the exercise of his functions. Appointment. The Council of Ministers are appointed by the Governor as per the recommendation given by Chief Minister and hold their office during pleasure of the Governor. It consists of Cabinet Ministers, Minister of State and Deputy Ministers. Powers and functions of Council of Ministers. The Council of Ministers of State perform the following functions. They perform individual work which has been assigned by Chief Minister. The Cabinet of Ministers can take major decisions on behalf of the Council of Ministers. Okay, next question. Explain the formation and functions of Supreme Court. The Supreme Court of India is apex court in Indian judicial system, highest level court in Indian judiciary system. According to Article Number 124 of the Constitution, the Parliament of India determines the number of judges for the Supreme Court. Today, the Supreme Court of India has 25 judges and Chief Justice. ಭಾರತದ ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್, ಇದು ಭಾರತೀಯ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಂಗ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಸಂವಿಧಾನದ 124ನೇ ವಿಧಿ ಪ್ರಕಾರ ಭಾರತದ ಸಂಸತ್ತು ಸರ್ವೋಚ್ಚ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯಕ್ಕೆ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಧೀಶರ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆಯನ್ನು ನಿರ್ಧರಿಸುತ್ತದೆ. ಇಂದು ಭಾರತದ ಸರ್ವೋಚ್ಚ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯದಲ್ಲಿ 25 ನ್ಯಾಯಾಧೀಶರು ಮತ್ತು ಒಬ್ಬರು ಮುಖ್ಯ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಧೀಶರು ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. The judges of the Supreme Court, including Chief Justice, are appointed by the President of India as per the advice of the Cabinet or Union Cabinet headed by Prime Minister. Pradhan Mantri ಮತ್ತು ಅವರ ಕ್ಯಾಬಿನೆಟ್ ಮಂತ್ರಿಗಳ ಸಲಹೆ ಮೇರೆಗೆ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರಪತಿಯವರು ಈ ಸರ್ವೋಚ್ಚ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯಕ್ಕೆ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಧೀಶರನ್ನು ಮತ್ತು ಮುಖ್ಯ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಧೀಶರನ್ನು ನೇಮಕ ಮಾಡುತ್ತಾರೆ. The judges will retire after the age of 65 years. Functions. Original jurisdiction. The power to hear and determine a dispute in the first instance between the states or center and state. Appellate jurisdiction. So, moola naya vapti naduvina vicharavannu kelalu mattu nirdharisuva adhikara rajyagalu mattu kendra mattu ರಾಜ್ಯಗಳ ನಡುವೆ ಏನಾದರೂ ವ್ಯತ್ಯಾಸ ಬಂದಾಗ ಈ ಒಂದು ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಅದನ್ನು ಬಗೆಹರಿಸುತ್ತದೆ. ಅಪಿಲೇಟ್ ಜುರಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ಷನ್, ಮೇಲ್ಮನವಿ ನ್ಯಾಯವ್ಯಾಪ್ತಿ, ಜುರಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಂದರೆ ನ್ಯಾಯವ್ಯಾಪ್ತಿ. ಮೇಲ್ಮನವಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರಕರಣಗಳನ್ನು ಆಲಿಸುವ ಅಧಿಕಾರವನ್ನು ಹೊಂದಿದೆ. ಥರ್ಡ್, ಹ್ಯಾಂಡಲ್ಸ್ ದ ಕೇಸಸ್ ಆಫ್ ವಯೊಲೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಫಂಡಮೆಂಟಲ್ ರೈಟ್ಸ್. Handles the cases of violation of fundamental rights. As I already explained now, every citizen of India by birth possesses the fundamental rights. If anybody using money power, political power, trying to exploit our fundamental rights, no. So we can go up to Supreme Court where we get a solution for this exploitation. The Supreme Court has original jurisdiction in many disputes arising out of election to the office of President and Vice President of India. Rashtrapati matu uparashtrapatigala padavige sambandhita enadaru prashnegalu udbhavisidare samasyegalu udbhavisidare adannu sarvochcha nyayalayavu bagiharisuttade. Supreme Court has appellate jurisdiction in the civil cases, criminal cases and constitutional matters. The Supreme Court has an advisory jurisdiction on any question of law or fact of public importance when President referred it to Supreme Court for its opinion. Under the Article Number 137, Supreme Court can review any judgment ordered made by it. Under the article number 129, the Supreme Court is a court of record. It maintains the records of proceedings, acts and decisions. It acts as a guardian of fundamental rights of citizens. It acts as guardian of our constitution. Okay. Next question. Explain formation functions of state high court. Famous question. High court. These are the middle level in the hierarchy of our Indian judiciary system and are subordinate to the apex court or supreme court. The high courts have full control over subordinate courts in the state. The constitution establishes high court in each state, but the parliament may establish by law a common high court for two or more states or union territories. Depending upon the size and population of state, now sometimes state will have independent high court, and sometime high court will be shared between two or three states depending upon their size and population. Okay, functions. These courts have no original jurisdiction in criminal cases and also a minimum in civil cases. But article number 226, high court can issue writs in the nature of habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition, certiorari, and quarto for enforcement of human rights. ನ್ಯಾಯಾಂಗದ ಶ್ರೇಣಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಮಧ್ಯಮ ಮಟ್ಟದಲ್ಲಿರುತ್ತದೆ ಮತ್ತು ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಅಥವಾ ಸರ್ವೋಚ್ಚ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯಕ್ಕೆ ಅಧೀನವಾಗಿ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಲಾಗುತ್ತದೆ. ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್ಗಳಿಗೆ ರಾಜ್ಯದ ಅಧೀನ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯಗಳ ಮೇಲೆ ಸಂಪೂರ್ಣ ನಿಯಂತ್ರಣವಿರುತ್ತದೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ಸಂವಿಧಾನವು ಪ್ರತಿ ರಾಜ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟನ್ನು ಸ್ಥಾಪಿಸುತ್ತದೆ, ಆದರೆ ಸಂಸತ್ತು ಮತ್ತು ಅಥವಾ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ರಾಜ್ಯಗಳಿಗೆ ಅಥವಾ ಕೇಂದ್ರಾಡಳಿತ ಪ್ರದೇಶಗಳಿಗೆ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯ ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟನ್ನು ಸ್ಥಾಪಿಸಬಹುದು. ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗೆ ಪಂಜಾಬ್ ಮತ್ತು ಹರಿಯಾಣ ರಾಜ್ಯಗಳಿಗೆ ಚಂಡೀಗಢ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದೇ ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಇರುತ್ತದೆ. Next question. Explain the formation functions of subordinate courts. ರಾಜ್ಯದ ಅಧೀನ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯಗಳಂತ ಕರೆಯಲಾಗುವುದು ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಅಂದರೆ. ಆರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ ನಂಬರ್ 235 ಪ್ರೊವೈಡ್ಸ್ ದ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಓವರ್ ದ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಬೈ ದಿ ಹೈ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ದಿ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್, ಕ್ರಿಮಿನಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ರೆವಿನ್ಯೂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್. ದ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಅ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಪ್ರಿಸೈಡೆಡ್ ಓವರ್ ಬೈ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಜಡ್ಜ್ ಹೂ ಈಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಸೆಷನ್ಸ್ ಜಡ್ಜಸ್ ಬಿಲೋ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್. ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಜಡ್ಜಸ್ ಆರ್ ಮುನ್ಸಿಪ್ಸ್. ಅಪೀಲ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಾಮ್ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಲೈ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಸೆಂಟ್ ಟು ಹೈ ಕೋರ್ಟ್. ಫಂಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್. ಇಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸಸೈಸ್ ಬೋತ್ ಒರಿಜಿನಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅಪಿಲೇಟ್ ಜ್ಯೂರಿಸ್ಡಿಕ್ಷನ್ ಇನ್ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಕೇಸಸ್. ಇಟ್ ಸೂಪರ್ವೈಸಸ್ ದ ಸಬಾರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್. ಕ್ರಿಮಿನಲ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಸೆಷನ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರಿಸೈಡೆಡ್ ಓವರ್ ಬೈ ದ ಸೆಷನ್ಸ್ ಜಡ್ಜ್. ಹಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಪಾಸ್ ದ ಡೆತ್ ಸೆಂಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಮರಣ ಶಿಕ್ಷೆ. ಡೆತ್ ಸೆಂಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಮರಣ ಶಿಕ್ಷೆ. ಬಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಕನ್ಫರ್ಮ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ದ ಹೈ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಕ್ಯೂಷನ್. ಬಿಲೋ ದಿಸ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ ಮುನ್ಸಿಪ್ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್, ದ ರೆವಿನ್ಯೂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಆರ್ ಹೆಡೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಕಲೆಕ್ಟರ್, ಅಸಿಸ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಕಮಿಷನರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ತಹಸೀಲ್ದಾರ್. ದಿ ಹಿಯರ್ ಆರ್ ರೆವಿನ್ಯೂ ಕೇಸಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಆಟ್ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ಸ್. ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್. ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ ದ ಫಾರ್ಮೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ತ್ರೀ ಟೈರ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಫಾರ್ ಲೋಕಲ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಗೌರ್ಮೆಂಟ್. ದ ರೂರಲ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಗೌರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಆಸ್ ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ರಾಜ್ ಆರ್ ಪಂಚಾಯತಿ ರಾಜ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ಸ್. ದ ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ರಾಜ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ಸ್ ಕನ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ತ್ರೀ ಟೈರ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್. ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ಆಟ್ ವಿಲೇಜ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್, ವಿಲೇಜ್ ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ಅಂತ ಕರೆಯಬಹುದು. ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ಆಟ್ ತಾಲೂಕು ಲೆವೆಲ್, ತಾಲೂಕು ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ಅಂತ ಕರೆಯಬಹುದು. ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ಆಟ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್, ಜಿಲ್ಲಾ ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ಅಂತ ಕರೆಯಲಾಗೋದು. ದಿಸ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಈಸ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಫಾರ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಪಾಪ್ಯುಲೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ 20 lakhs. ಇಫ್ ದ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಪಾಪ್ಯುಲೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಲೆಸ್ ದ್ಯಾನ್ 20 lakhs, ದೇರ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಪಂಚಾಯತ್ ರಾಜ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಆಟ್ ತಾಲೂಕು ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ. अर्बन लोकल गवर्नमेंट्स और नगर पालिकास, म्युनिसिपल कॉर्पोरेशंस, म्युनिसिपल काउंसिल्स, नगर पंचायत्स. सो डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द साइज ऑफ अर्बन एरियाज, हियर आल्सो वी हैव थ्री लेवल लोकल बॉडी एट अर्बन साइड: म्युनिसिपल कॉर्पोरेशंस, म्युनिसिपल काउंसिल्स, नगर पंचायत्स. ओके, so this is a brief idea behind formation of three tier system for local self government at rural side as well as urban side. So with this discussion, let us end part 2 session of Indian Constitution unit of professional ethics and Indian Constitution subject. So with this, let us end our part 2 discussion. Thank you.